Because we've got the mic and go to that speaker. But the piano is just breaking up.
That would be the original sound part. Okay. Yeah. But can I figure out how to get it there? This I don't know.
Okay. So you want to go to settings?
The Zoom menu.
Zoom. Oh gosh.
Good morning. Welcome.
I don't know how to go to the Zoom menu.
None of you have melted. That's good to see. You're all still here. It's wonderful. Thank you for coming this morning. Did any of you go to Symphony last night? I didn't see you. It was wonderful, wasn't it? It was a lot of fun. Yeah, they did a great job. So let us join in prayer. Holy God, you remind us in so many ways all of the things we have to be grateful for. This space, these people, this community, events like last night that remind us that we can be so different and yet be together and be present with one another in such beautiful ways. We are grateful for you and for your presence with us today. In your Son's holy name, amen. Let's sing.
We are the old, you're for your face. We have been so.
announcements that I have. Bible study is on Wednesday at 10:30 at the airport at the retreat. It went pretty well last week, so I think we're going to continue. I think. Bernie Faye, you think? Awesome. And then a little announcement about our Girls Thrive. We have been informed that Girls Thrive will be moving out of our building, I think August 1st, so that's coming right around the corner. Apparently, they were offered some free space by another church. So
yeah, we'll miss them, but we wish them well, and we will continue to support that organization. Are there any other announcements? Jane?
Well, since it's an announcement, I'm going to say we had a slight heart attack on Dick this week. He ended up being smart and going in and taking aspirin. Said, well, and it was just pressure. Didn't feel terribly about everything. Took himself to our ER, and then they, excuse me, the North Clinic urgent care. And then they, of course, he'll have to tell you, call him to hear about the ambulance ride. It's pretty funny. Anyway, so he had two stents put in Thursday when everything went fine. He was out by Friday afternoon, which was great. And he's still feeling fine. Thank goodness he is a left-handed guy because I did everything on his right arm. They were all laughing about that. So anyway, that's an announcement in my family. Also, we have some exciting news too. And if hoping I'm asking everyone just to participate, is that it is Rose Powell's birthday. Is she on? Oh. Anyway, she her birthday's tomorrow. She's turning 70. And so anyone that I have ran into, I said, you know, the most important, if you want to send a card, that's a little late on that end. But I said, just text her. You don't even have, it's hard for her to pick up the phone in time. So, but if you text her and said happy birthday to her, I think she would be thrilled. So that's just a little thing. Dick had mentioned last night too that Gene Lotz had come over and visited him earlier this week. Everything's fine with him. His gulch that he was up was protected. So he wasn't really affected at all. So that was great to hear too. So that's my announcements. I feel like I'm the gossip column here.
We need that here though.
Well, yes. And so anyway, everyone have a great day. Thank you.
Thanks, Jane. I do know that Renee and her husband were able to move back home when they lifted the ban. So they did stay at the church for, I think, a couple nights, but they are back home. So that's good for them as well. And as far as I know, the ban is still lifted. Oh, I see a chat. It says, hi, Rose. Good morning. So maybe Rose is actually on.
I think we need to stay down the bird.
She is gone, so let's do that.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Rose. Happy birthday to you.
We saw you on, Rose, and we hope that you're having a happy birthday. Are there any other announcements? Okay, hearing none, let's sing.
Sure. If you want to, you're always welcome.
Because one indeed. Sometimes it's hard to tell truth from not the truth. What do you think? Is that hard? When I was maybe a little older than you, I remember when my mom and my dad tried to teach me to do the right thing and to know what was right and know what was wrong. And sometimes I wasn't very good at that. But even so, when I did something that was wrong, I kind of knew it. And I think I still know it to this day. And sometimes we know things even if we don't know exactly why. And sometimes we know the truth even when it doesn't seem like it at first. Yeah, and sometimes Papa has owies on his legs. And that's true. But anyway, we get all kinds of messages about truth. A second. You get messages from your computer or from your friends? Oh, do you have friends that tell you things? Yeah. And do you believe everything they tell you? I mean, how about when your grandpa tells you something, do you believe everything he says? I do. I believe everything your grandpa says. But anyway, God wants us to be careful about what we hear and what we believe. He wants us to have the truth. And when it's not the truth, he wants us to discard it. Should we do a short prayer? All right, ready? God, we ask your help in sorting out what is good and letting go of what is not. Amen. And now we're going to read scripture. So, one hand to change. All right, I think this is good for you. I forget to grab it. All right. I have it in a couple of places. All right, we're going to read this. Okay. This is 1 Thessalonians. Isn't that a great name, Thessalonian? 5:12-24. We appeal to you all, sisters and brothers, or friends and kin, to acknowledge those who labor with you all and lead you all in Christ and admonish you all. Esteem them more than before in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. Now we urge you, kindred, to admonish the undisciplined, encourage the discouraged, support the weak, and be patient with all. See that none of you repays evil for evil. Rather, always seek to do good with one another and to all. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In all things give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you all. Quench not the spirit. Do not despise the words of women or men who prophesy. Rather examine everything. To what is good, hold fast. Avoid every appearance of evil. May the very God of peace sanctify you all wholly, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Redeemer Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful and will do this.
See me coming up here with a stack of papers, and I know some people go, oh, gee. I promise it's not that long. There's handouts in there. This life is filled with such incredible juxtapositions. The beautiful sunset, made beautiful because of the smoke of forest fires. The celebration of symphony under the stars, against the backdrop of strife and division that plague us. We as a church are struggling to understand who and what we are to become in a country where more and more people claim a no religion, and where our fellow believers seem as strange to us as the Gentiles did to the Jews. I find myself wondering what Paul would write to us if Paul was still in the business of writing letters of support to churches. In Thessalonica, in Paul's day, there was a small community of believers, and there was a larger community of opposition. Some viewed that support of Jesus weakened support for Rome. And most Gentiles opposed Christianity's exclusive claims on people's lives. Christianity, not named as such yet, was becoming a powerful challenge to the existing order of things. And of course we know challenge and change create tension and conflict. And Paul spent time in this community, time with this church. He leaves them after a while, and later he sends Timothy to encourage them and to strengthen them. And then he follows up Timothy's visit with this letter to encourage them to remain steady in their course. Written, as Abraham Smith writes, to encourage a beleaguered church to persist in its new way of life, in accordance with the apocalyptic gospel it has received, despite the fact that it might have been difficult for the members to see the power of God and the prestige pertaining to that power at work in their lives. We are that believer church, and this letter, it's written to us. Us as a congregation, as we try to discern what direction we are to take, who we are to become, what we are to contribute in this world that sometimes seems like it wants nothing to do with us. It's also written to us as a denomination within the larger global Christian community that seems to spend more of its time on internal strife and infighting than on doing the historical mission work of caring for the poor and the marginalized. What labor and work can we take on to make this church productive in its distinctive life? Last week, you received some information about poverty. This week, we'll receive some information about human trafficking. Why? Because these are two issues that directly impact our community. And because these two issues are so tightly bound to each other and to the organizations we work so closely with. There are also issues that have plagued humanity since the very beginning. And finally, there are also issues that many of us would like to avoid, to shy away from or shield ourselves from. It's easy, as we saw last week, to condemn the stranger, to lay blame at the feet of the individual who is impoverished, and not so easy to recognize, acknowledge, much less repent for all the ways that we have contributed to their circumstances, or the ways that we have perpetuated the stories and the systems that churn poverty out like butter. More importantly, at least to me, they are issues that remain at the center of our gospel commission. Paul's letter to the church at Thessalonica, and really his letter to us, is a reminder that church is family. Not the nuclear, separate, private family we've come to know and become accustomed to in this country, but that ever-reaching extended family. Paul's letter is also a reminder that we are called to trust our God and one another, instead of treating each other with wariness and suspicion. What a challenge this is in a time where mudslinging and fear-mongering has reached epic proportions, only overshadowed by the ever-increasing wave of violence that we face. Paul's letter is a reminder that we are not simply to tolerate the poor and the outcast, or to look out for our children and the other potential victims we encounter, but to truly identify with them, to embrace them as our own, to welcome them, not because we were told we should, but because we truly believe they belong. And perhaps the most difficult piece of this letter is the admonishment from Paul that we are to be thankful for everything. How do we find gratitude in the midst of such horror and suffering? This is the challenge of our faith. This living in the tension of the already and the not yet. This partially realized eschatology that reminds us in one moment that Jesus died for our sins, and in the next calls us to continue the work of redemption and salvation. For Paul, and hopefully for us, we can find the way to the understanding, and that we can give thanks in every circumstance. And the way to do that is by keeping God at the center of our lives. If worship of God is the context for our whole life, not just for this little piece of time in this beautiful space, but for the whole totality of our life, then gratitude becomes a necessary and inevitable product. Gratitude is not governed by circumstance, but by the life of worship. And the life of worship means to be perpetually thankful. We get so caught up in the minutiae of the details of life, the superficial and the shallow, that we lose sight of the bigger picture, the rich depth of life. Until life breaks us open and reminds us of, often it's through grief and pain, but life breaks us open and reminds us of how deeply we love and how desperately we want to live. And for that, I'm grateful. We're going to watch a couple short videos about human trafficking. The first one is from the federal government's Blue Campaign, which is an awareness campaign. And then the second one is a little short video about the myths of human trafficking. So sit back and see what you hear.
What is human trafficking? Human trafficking is modern-day slavery. It is the exploitation of a person through force, fraud, or coercion. Human smuggling and human trafficking are different crimes. Human smuggling is the illegal movement of someone across a border. Human trafficking is the illegal exploitation of a person. Human trafficking, not transportation. Human trafficking is a highly modern slavery.
It is the exploitation of a person through force, fraud, or coercion. Smuggling and human trafficking are different crimes. Human smuggling is the illegal movement of someone across a border. Human trafficking is the illegal exploitation of a person. Human trafficking is about exploitation, not transportation. Human trafficking is a highly profitable crime and a violation of human rights. It occurs in every part of the world, including here in the United States. It happens in our big cities, our suburbs, and even in rural towns. It can happen to anyone. Human trafficking victims can be US citizens or from other countries. Victims can be any age, race, or gender. But one thing they share is that they are vulnerable to being exploited. There are different types of human trafficking, including are manipulated or forced against their will to engage in sex acts for money. Sex traffickers might use violence, threats, manipulation, or the promise of love and affection to lure victims. Truck stops, hotel rooms, rest areas, street corners, clubs, private residences. These are just some of the places where victims are forced to sell sex. Any person under the age of 18 involved in a commercial sex act is considered a victim of human trafficking. No exceptions. Forced labor takes on many forms, and it happens here in the US and overseas. Through force, fraud, or coercion, victims are made to work for little or no pay. Very often, these victims are forced to manufacture or grow the products that we use and consume every day. Victims of forced labor could be found in factories, on farms, doing construction work, and more. Victims of domestic servitude are hidden in plain sight, forced to work in homes across the United States. Their traffickers sometimes take their identification papers and travel documents in order to limit their freedom. They are prisoners, working as nannies, maids, or domestic help. Every year in the United States, thousands of human trafficking cases are reported, but many more go unnoticed. That's because human trafficking is a hidden crime. Victims might be afraid to come forward, or we may not recognize the signs, even if it's happening right in front of us. We need to bring this crime out of the shadows and help combat this heinous crime by raising awareness of human trafficking around the country. But we can't do it alone. We need your help. So what can you do to stop human trafficking? Visit the Blue Campaign website to learn more about the signs and indicators of human trafficking. Share this video on social media to help bring this crime out of the shadows. Be an informed consumer. Know who makes the products you buy and the food you eat to help keep slavery-tainted items out of your home. And finally, recognize and report suspected human trafficking. You can submit a tip to federal law enforcement online or by phone. For victim support, you can call or text the National Human Trafficking Resource Center. Help us bring this crime out of the shadows and into the light. Join the Blue Campaign. One voice. One mission, end human trafficking.
Okay, beautiful. Don't go too far now. You've got three more guys coming tonight. Hey, beautiful. Don't go too far now. You've got three more guys coming tonight.
Down and come on in because I have some friends that want to meet you.
As some of you know, I spent some time working with and returning young people who had been trafficked. And a few weeks ago when I was in chaplain training, it was the focus of almost an entire week of training. And my work with the victims and my learning as a chaplain were separated by about 16 years. We knew in 2008 that we had a trafficking problem in Montana. We're only now educating the public. We're only now educating our chaplains. And we're only now really taking a hard look at what's happening in our communities. Anytime you have a large gathering event, rodeos, sports events, Super Bowl is one of the biggest, you have a spike in human trafficking. One of the biggest spikes in Montana, in Helena, Montana, happens around legislative session. If that doesn't disturb you, I don't know what will. When you think about the coming legislative session, when you think about our community and the safety and well-being of our community, I urge you to put your faith at the center of that, to look for God in all of this. What are you being called to do? I've told you before, I won't tell you how to vote because I don't have a clue. But really think about it. If having legislative session here puts our community at higher risk, who are we electing? As we turn our time open and open into our prayer time. I know these things are hard to hear. I know there's things in our hearts that are hard to say out loud, but God help us, we need to raise our voices. We cannot be silent. So I invite you to speak aloud the concerns and the joys of your heart. Let us pray. Holy God, divine conqueror, author of our lives, and author and giver of grace. We have no idea where you are calling us, and yet we pledge to do the best that we can with the gifts that we've been given, and we try to listen. Show us, please, who and what you call us to be in these moments ahead as we make decisions that impact not only us as a congregation, but us as a community and as a broader world. For what and for whom do we pray today?
Learn more about what we can do about these evils in the world that we saw in the videos today.
Prayer that we can learn more and do more about the evils that face the world today.
That we open our eyes and recognize those things that don't sit quite right with us. And that we open our mouths and say something or do something.
Prayers of gratitude for our crew, Monica, Arlene, and Rose, and my own family.
Prayers of gratitude for those who aren't sitting in the church today with us, but who are very much in our hearts, our family, our friends.
Prayers of
Holy One, sometimes our prayers are about these big, big things that seem to be so overwhelming. And we feel so small. What can we do? And then sometimes there are those things that are so intimate to us, so close to us, that in the big scheme of things, they might seem insignificant to others, but they are devastating to us. And sometimes it's in joy and celebration that we are overwhelmed, and sometimes it's by the flood of tears and rage. And we know that you are with us through it all. You just ask us to trust that you're there. Help us to trust. As we say the prayer that your Son taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This has been a lot for Grandpa today. Pretty heavy thinking to do, and lots of busyness. But I so appreciate Pastor Gloria being okay with a couple of kiddos running around. I think about when Jesus was doing his preaching by the sea. Can you imagine the confusion that was probably surrounding him? Well, Pastor Gloria does a great job. But as I was reviewing the scripture for this week, and I didn't know what all Gloria was doing, to talk about, I zeroed in on the word truth. And as I do, when I start thinking about things, I go to my resources and I started with the Merriam-Webster Dictionary. Truth, the body of real things, events, and facts, actuality. Or number two, the state of being, the case, fact. Or number three, and I really like this one, often capitalized, a transcendent, fundamental, or spiritual reality. So that got me off on truth. And I started doing the internet thing, looking up some things about sayings that are purportedly true. And I'm going to leave it up to you to see if you believe that or not, but I thought some of these were pretty good. They're about truth. Lies are simple. Truth is complex. A lie gets halfway around the world before the truth has a chance to get its pants on. If you tell the truth, you don't have to remember anything. Truth is like the sun. You can shut it out for a time, but it ain't going away. Anyone who doesn't take the truth seriously in small matters cannot be trusted in large ones. Rather than love, than money, than fame, give me truth. All truth passes through three stages. First, it is ridiculed. Second, it is violently opposed. Third, it is accepted as being self-evident. Three things cannot be hidden: the sun, the moon, and the truth. All of these are from various people, like, if you're interested, you can look them up, you know, as to who purportedly said them. By the way, it's really hard to sometimes attribute who said what. But this one I did look up from the Nobel Peace Prize website. It's by Martin Luther King in 1964. I believe that unarmed truth and unconditional love will have the final word in reality. That is why right, temporarily defeated, is stronger than evil triumphant. And then lastly, I am the way and the truth and the life. And I'll attribute that one to Jesus Christ. I'll leave it up to you if you wish to check these out for yourself as to whether or not you think they're true. One thing I believe in all my heart to be true, and that is all are welcome at Christ's table.
And on that night when Jesus sat with his disciples and they shared a meal together, he blessed bread and he blessed cup. He broke the bread and he shared it with them. This is new life given to all people. Whenever you eat, do it in remembrance of Jesus. And he took a cup and he shared it with them. He poured wine. So this is a new promise poured out for all people. Whenever you drink, do so in remembrance of Jesus.
Do you agree with me? God of all, at this table, we see the way. We see the truth. We see the life. At this table, we are fed. Amen.
Come and
oh.
Truth and how hard it is to sometimes tell us the truth. It's also hard to tell when you're having a heart attack sometimes, so I'm told. So please pass on to Dick. But, we're glad he did the nice thing. We give a prayer of thanksgiving with me this morning. God of all, you gave us intellect, skills, spirit, and truth. In return, we give of our finances and of our talents and our time. We are blessed in receiving and we are blessed in giving. Amen.
The life of his people. I'll wait till Gloria says the thing and I'll sing the other words, I suppose. Sorry.
We do the best we can with what we have.
That means I didn't send all the words.
No, you did. Well, you sent some.
Some of them. That's a start.
I want to express my gratitude to all of you for being here. And I want to express my gratitude to these two little people, Atlas and Lyra, for reminding us how to play, because we all need a little more of that. As you move forward into the day, I encourage you to really consider what it means to say all are welcome. Keep your eyes wide open. And move forward with God at the center of your lives. Amen.
Trying to see how to stop recording, but I'm wondering if I forgot to record today. Ah, oh no.